Welcome back. According to new research, January is the most popular month of the year to change career. However, older professionals are still more fearful than millennials when it comes to making the change.
So how can you put your best foot forward when looking for a new job? Career expert Rowan Kennedy joins us now with some advice. You're very welcome to the show.
Morning,
how are
Rowan.
You today?
Good morning.
Good, good. Now, tell me this. How do you know when it is definitely time for a career change? Because I think everybody at some stage will think to themselves, oh, come on, I'm just sick of this, the routine. But how do you know when it's actually time for a career change?
Yeah, really great question. So I suppose the way you really know is if you find that your job, your career is not meeting your needs. That is the primary thing. So everyone's got different needs and everyone likes to meet them in different types of ways. So it's identifying what needs are most important to you and then finding, are these being met? You'll probably know really, really strong if they're not being met. And then finding how you can find those needs being met in a new role. So for example, if somebody feels that my company just isn't secure or my job isn't secure or my prospects aren't secure, I don't have financial stability, they might think, right, it's not just I want, I would like to move, I absolutely have to move.
Yeah.
Because I'm concerned about the security of my family, about my financial stability and so on. Other people, they feel like they might be stagnating, they might feel like there's a lack of growth. And for them, that is an absolute burning need. So in that case, it becomes very clear. It's distinct from values, which are nice to have, needs are need to have.
Yeah.
So if they don't feel they've got the stability, they need to go. If they don't feel they have the growth, they need to go. Other people, they might feel isolated, for example. They're the only person working in a department, or they're not getting support from management, or the environment might be toxic. So they feel that they're really, really alone. And if they're someone who really likes connection, really likes support, working with colleagues, then they feel, I need to go somewhere else.
Ronan, you just touched on this there, Paul, when you were talking about needing to go, wanting to go. But given the fact that we spend so much time of our lives in the office, in work, what's our expectation of sort of the happiness quota that we need? Like, what's the ratio? Because everyone's going to be annoyed with their job at some point in time.
Yeah.
But in general, should we be 60% happy or is it about 80%?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So you're not going to be happy with everything all of the time. I think a really good ratio is 80%. I think if you're enjoying and you're satisfied with 80% of what you're doing and you can deal with or put up with the other 20%, that's a really good ratio.
So taking that ratio into account, and if you've decided now is the time to jump for whatever your personal reasons are, and what are the correct procedures to follow before you leave? Because presumably you want to leave on good terms with your previous employer.
Yep. So this is one of the big questions that a lot of people would ask. How do I leave? And then once I leave, what's the process of leaving and going through that efficiently? So I suppose making sure that you maintain the relationship, that you leave on good terms, that they understand that you need to do it for personal reasons. It's kind of like, you know, it's not you, it's me. So understanding that, look, it's been great. I've learned a lot. You know, I'm very grateful for the opportunities I've had. And I would stay if there was an opportunity for me to stay that was going to like benefit the business. And then having a smooth transition. So ensuring your employer that you'll train the next person up, that you'll ensure that your standard operating procedures or whatever your structure of work is passed over correctly. So they'll feel better about that if you feel you're looking after them and it's a smooth transition.
You might need a good reference as well.
Well, exactly. And just with that in mind, how honest should you be? So say your manager is a bit rubbish and the department has run a little bit badly and you're about to walk out the door and you can see these things very clearly because so often it's in front of someone's nose and they can't see it. So with a reference in mind and with not upsetting the apple cart too much in mind, how honest should you be?
Well, I always advocate for people to be honest because people will always tell if you're not being honest, especially a professional interviewer. They'll be able to notice subtleties in your body language and your conversation if you're not honest. But how honest should you be? I think you should be honest, but I think you should be diplomatic as well. So focus on constructive things. So you've heard of the confidence sandwich. So say something that's really good and that's positive, and then put in something that's constructive. So I think this could be done better. And here's a couple of suggestions of how I think it should be done.
Okay.
And then here's another positive thing that I think is good moving forward.
Fair enough.
So to try, be a little bit diplomatic because, look, we're all sensitive about, you know, our jobs and we're all sensitive about how we spend our time.
Exactly.
In an ideal scenario, you would have another job waiting for you. So you're going to leave one and not necessarily take a hit financially. Of course, that doesn't work out all the time. But when you are entering a new business, in terms of how you conduct yourself and how you apply yourself, what are the goals that we would need to set?
So when entering a new business, yeah, I suppose it is really good to have a new job set up before you leave. You've got stronger negotiating power. It also makes you feel more self-assured, more
the safety more comfortable. Net there.
The safety net is there straight away. So I think going into a new job, starting off on the right foot with colleagues, understanding how they like to be communicated with, understanding the goals or the key performance indicators like KPIs, that's the sort of jargon that's used, and making sure that you're working through the processes in a way that that fits the environment that you're in. So some people work very quickly, some people work a little bit more slowly, some people like decisions to be made over a longer period of time. So trying to understand those and not just come in and say, well, this is what I've done before and this is amazing, and people will be like, whoa, well, that's, you know. So I guess understanding the culture really well and trying to fit into that, and then giving it time if you've got like a lot of ideas or if you're very innovative, giving you a bit of time before you kind of introduce you know, your own stamp.
Tread lightly.
Yeah,
that is good advice.
That's a perfect way of saying.
So, for people that aren't lucky enough to have a job lined up, then people are terrified of interviews. People are terrified of trying to cobble together a CV that maybe they haven't tried to cobble together for 10 or 15 or 20 years. Yeah. They think things have moved on and it's impossible. Mm-hmm. Give us a few nice and easy tips to take the fear out of it and push them forward a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So, I suppose starting very, very simply, what are your skills? What do you do? And breaking it down into major skills. So, for example, have you experienced doing project coordination? Do you have experience doing operations? Do you have experience doing administration, event planning? These types of things.
Yeah.
Major skills where you can elaborate on them, as opposed to the sort of skills that make up those, like which could be problem solving, communication. Still important, but they're kind of the more minor skills. So, starting off with that, so if you're going to describe what you do, if you say that you've experienced in these three types of skills, then if you're going to talk about your biggest responsibilities after that, then talk about your biggest successes, abilities that you have, soft skills that you have.
Yeah.
And if you collect all of those types of points, put them at the very top of your CV. So the very first thing somebody will see from you is the best of what you've got to offer. Right? And if you really want to have a home run on that, it's relating that back to the requirements of the role that you're looking at.
So they're impressed with your CV. They've asked you in for an interview. Give us some interview tips.
Interview tips. Well, I suppose preparing for the interview, making sure that you really understand the job in detail, the requirements of the role. So when someone says, you know, why do you think you're a good fit for the role, or tell us about yourself, you can tell them about everything you've achieved, the experience you have, the education you have in relation to the role.
So tailoring it, that's the key.
Tailoring it very specifically.
Yeah.
Because we all want our needs met. We all want to make sure that we're making a good decision. You have to remember that the interviewer themselves is probably a little bit nervous. They're like, I want to make sure I hire the right person because it's going to reflect on me. So how do we communicate and demonstrate really clearly to them that you are the right person and that they're going to make a good decision? So that's by telling them, look, I meet the requirements of your role and I've done many of the responsibilities of the role already in a previous role.
Yeah.
Also, on top of that, if there is any shortfall or if there is anything I haven't specifically done before, great, that's the growth that I want. So I'm embracing that challenge. So don't worry about it.
Just do the interview for us.
You're right.
You smash it.
Yeah, you belt it, wouldn't you?
Yeah,
absolutely.
What about asking the interviewer questions? Is that allowed?
Absolutely, absolutely.
It's encouraged, as you were saying earlier these days, isn't it?
Great
point.
So ask the interviewer questions. Why? Well, it shows that you're particularly interested in the role and it allows them to talk a little bit about what they're interested in, hopefully.
Yeah.
So a couple of questions I think are really nice is, well, what do you enjoy most about working here? Right? Because that allows them to really focus in on something that they like or they're proud of or that makes them happy.
Nice question.
Yeah, that is nice. Yeah. And we were chatting and we were laughing at me earlier, Ronan, about the fact that I used to burrow holes in people's heads trying to maintain eye contact and shaking their hand and then pulling their arm off. Body language, though, is that important in an interview? Do you need to be sitting upright? Do you need to be looking interested? That type of thing, just briefly.
Yeah, absolutely. Body language is, of course, most people like to speak to someone who seems open as opposed to having their arms closed or their legs closed.
Right.
Not that there's necessarily a massive amount of psychology behind that, but that's just what it feels. It just feels better that way.
It's a chat. Think of it as a chat.
Exactly, having a chat. And I think your eye contact point is very very correct. So making a reasonable amount of eye contact.
But not too much.
Not staring them out of it.
Don't terrify them.
And then not totally looking at the ground either. So,
okay.
Ronan, thanks a million for coming in today and for all those great tips. And, of course, best of luck to anyone out there who is considering a change of career.
Good to meet you. Thanks.